Hey guys, welcome back to Reserved Investments on YouTube. And this is a video I had no plans of making at all. This is a video I thought I would never have to put out on this particular YouTube channel. In fact, very little planning, as it probably shows, went into the filming of this particular video at present time. This is one of the videos where I just came down here, I turn the camera on, I talk for several minutes, I upload the video and hope for the best. What I am going to be doing in this video is I am going to be talking about the three main pitfalls that make opening up a retail brick and mortar shop in any type of antique or collectibles business in the year 2021 a bad idea. Now, to be fair, are there people that can successfully open up a retail shop in the year 2021 that caters to certain markets in the antiques trade, the collectibles trade, the art market, the antiquities market? The answer is yes, but they are few and far between. They are the exception, not the rule. And going back to my original point, the reason why I thought I would never have to make this video is if you guys watch a lot of other YouTube creator content in the collectible space, you probably come across some YouTubers that have several hundred thousands of subscribers where they talk about this very concept. One in particular, and I'm going to give a shout out here, is Rudy with Alpha Investments. He runs a channel on collectible card games, and he talks about some of the pitfalls of opening up a collectible card game business and other collectible spaces in the year 2020, 2021, and beyond. As a matter of fact, back in 2017, 2018, he did a series of videos on this that I thought were spectacular, to the point where when I was writing the rough draft for a lot of the videos that I was going to do on this channel, I actually omitted this talking point because Rudy with Alpha Investments literally hit the nail on the head with all of the talking points that he put in those particular videos. As a matter of fact, I'm going to tell you this. If you have yet to see those videos, please go to Alpha Investments, his YouTube channel, and search card shop, opening up collectible card store, until you find those videos from 2017, 2018, where he went into depth on these talking points. Now, I'm going to expand on some of these talking points in this video because we're now in the year 2021. Things are a little bit different. We went through the corona crash. We went through the pandemic. We had mask mandates. We had a lot of closures. We had a lot of people struggling in the brick and mortar space. Now, I want to make this very clear because I am often attacked by a lot of the Timmys, Kimmys, and Poindexters that don't understand the fundamentals that go into a lot of these markets. And they reach out to me and they say, look at that guy. He's pro-antique. He's biased against collectibles. Therefore, everything that he says is absolutely wrong because he doesn't like these collectible markets. I want to be very clear, guys. Obviously, if you spend any amount of time on this channel, you know, number one, that that's not true. And number two, that this video pertains to anybody on the collectible side of the trade. That means those of you that want to open up a comic book shop, a video game shop, a Lego shop, a vintage toy shop, a collectible card game shop, or even if you're on the antique side of the equation and you reach out to me and you say, Sean, I want to utilize your consulting services because I live in a wealthy suburb of the state of Connecticut or New York City or Los Angeles or Seattle, and I want to open up a high-profile investment-grade coin and currency collectible store, I would give you the same advice that I'm giving to a lot of the people that reach out to me and ask for my advice on opening up a vintage video game shop or even a comic book shop. It's all the same, guys. So what I'm going at here is I don't care if you're on the antique side of the trade. I don't care if you deal in high-end art. I don't care if you deal in thousand-year-old antiquities, or I don't care if you got a thing for Pikachus, Planeswalkers, Marios, Sonic the Hedgehogs, Iron Men, Batgirls, whatever your thing is. This applies to you, and I want to make that very clear. Now, there are three main pitfalls that people fall into when they want to open up a retail shop that they can easily avoid if they put together a proper written plan, understand business basics, understand basics of the antiques and collectibles trade, both in the short term and the long term, and also just take a step back, remove all emotion that they have from the business that they're about to enter in, and realistically understand what's going to go in to you or anybody out there that wants to open up a retail brick and mortar store that deals with antiques or collectibles in the year 2021 and beyond. The first problem that I have with most people that go this route, they are not realistic as to what opportunities are available in the antiques and collectibles trade in the year 2021 and beyond. And let's forget about the pandemic for now. Let's put all that aside. Let's assume that the pandemic never happened. Even if you came to me right now asking for advice, I would still answer in this manner, and I'm going to explain why. There's a lot of people out there that are getting involved in these markets because they see video games at all-time highs, or they see vintage comic books selling for extremely high price levels right now, or maybe they have an attachment to Magic the Gathering, Pokemon, Yu-Gi-Oh, other collectible card games, and every week, every month, you hear an auction company state a new record price for a lot of these items. Now, I myself, for those of you that don't know me, I'm not only a consultant in the antiques and collectibles trade, I do write for Antiques and Auction News. So on a regular basis, I'm exposed to all these high profile headlines that are put out by the trade, because obviously in a lot of the articles that I write, I comment on this stuff. And I can tell you, there's a lot of publications that cater to the antiques and collectibles trade that a lot of you out there have never even heard of. If I bring up Maine Antique Digest, or if I bring up Antique Trader, or if I bring up the Journal of Antiques and Collectibles, or even if I bring up Antiques and Auction News, which is the publication that I write for, I'm sure a lot of you guys have not heard or have even went and read any of those publications on a regular basis. Now, where am I going with this? Well, all those publications, even publications that cater to the high-end antique market, I'm talking 1% to 3% of the market where, you know, you get a lot of very wealthy, snobby people that are operating in that market. Even those publications have talked about the value of vintage video games, the value of Magic the Gathering, the value of Pokemon, the value of vintage toys, the value of vintage comic books. And they have each reported on a lot of these record-breaking sales in the trade. Now, where am I going with this? It's gotten to the point where not only publications in the antiques and the collectibles trade are commenting on these record-breaking sales, so is Fox Business, so is CNN, so is ABC News, so is the Wall Street Journal, so is the New York Times. And what's interesting is we are now in a place where the average person can tune in every single week to American Pickers, Pawn Stars, Antiques Roadshow, and they could get literally market advice on the fact as to what's hot and what's not in the overall antiques and collectibles trade. My point being is that the average person out there is not oblivious to how much some of this stuff is selling for. So some of you guys have it in your head, I'm going to open up a retail shop that caters to vintage video games or comic books, and you think that little Timmy or Timmy Senior, who's 60 years old, is going to walk in with his pristine collection of Super Nintendo games, PlayStation games, or a complete run of Action Comics or X-Men or something that's in immaculate condition that you're going to be able to buy on pennies on the dollar and sell for an exorbitant markup in your store, and it's going to pay for all your overhead to the point where all you got to worry about going forward is if you want to stock newer products, if you want to deal with wholesalers, if you want to deal with distributors, you're going to make all this money in vintage products. I am here to tell you, in the year 2021, the average person knows the value of these items. It's no different why I have people who are reaching out to me, scratching their head, going, Sean, I don't understand. In 2020, 2021, even 2017, 2018, I'm going to flea markets. I'm going to antique marts. I'm going to garage sales. I'm not getting really any great finds, with few exceptions. You talk about your videos in the 1990s, in the early 2000s, you were going to flea markets. You were going to antique marts, and you were making a fortune flipping this stuff online. You need to understand, in the 1990s, in the early 2000s, we didn't have smartphones. The average person was not sitting at home on a Wednesday or a Thursday night watching Pawn Stars, Antiques Roadshow, American Pickers, Storage Wars. They weren't knowing what this stuff was worth. If they wanted to know what it had value-wise, they had to do research. In the year 2021, anyone can walk into an antique shop, can walk into an antique mall, can go to an antique mart. Hell, you can even go to a flea market and you can come across one of the articles that I wrote. One of the articles that a colleague in a lot of these markets of mine wrote about these high prices being paid for vintage toys, comic books, whatever we're talking about, the information is there. This idea that you're going to open up a vintage video game store, a comic book store, and so-and-so is just going to walk in with all these valuable items, and they're going to sell it to you for pennies on the dollar, and you're going to be able to constantly flip that stuff and pay all your expenses, your overhead, your rent, your mortgage, your heating bill, your air conditioning, whatever it is that you have to pay to upkeep that business, is a Ponzi dream. Notice I did not say a Ponzi scheme. It very well could happen. You might be the exception to the rule where somebody comes walking into your business on 3 days after your grand opening and says, hey, I have this collection of near mint Sega Saturn games that I want to trade in. And I don't know what any of this stuff is worth. Just make me an offer. I want to get rid of it. My kid went to college. I hated that kid. He's out of my hair. I just want to sell this stuff and move on. You may get lucky. And little Timmy's collection of 15 rare Sega Saturn games that literally probably in today's market would sell for $10,000 gets sold for $200 and a bottle of soda. You know, I've seen crazy things like that happen, but it is not the norm, guys. It is not something you can depend on. Another mistake, another pitfall that a lot of you guys don't realize when you get into these markets, especially when you're working with retail stores, brick and mortar stores, and the like, is the time demands. A lot of you guys reach out to me and you say, Sean, you know what? I got this all figured out. I'm in my late 20s. I'm in my early 30s. Maybe you're married. Maybe you have a kid. Maybe your woman, your significant other, or even if you're female and you want to do this, your guy that you're with, they're all in your corner, meaning they want you to do this. They're willing to stick through you thick and thin, or so they think, and you're going to take this risk. I'm here to tell you, a lot of marriages, a lot of relationships are not going to survive this. And I'm also going to tell you that if you are single like me, like my last relationship, my last LTR was in 2019. So I am in the dating pool right now. If you are single and you think you're going to be able to open up a retail shop, you're going to be able to give 100% to that business with retail hours as they are in the year 2021, and you're going to go into the dating market and you expect to literally have success, you're going to date a chick in your 30s, 40s, 50s, and you think she's going to understand that you have a retail store to also cater to, and maybe you're not even making that much money in that retail store and you think she's going to stay by your side through thick and thin. I am sorry. As a single guy, as a high value guy who has money, who dates, I can tell you most women in the year 2021, if they're in their 30s, if they're in their 40s, and if you guys are dating women in your 50s, which maybe if you're in your 60s or 70s, that is something that you're doing. I don't know. But if you are, I'm going to tell you, most high-value women, they want the guy to already have his shit sorted out. Meaning, if you run this like a business or an investment where you have employees, where you're just there maybe 3-4 hours a day, meaning you have a system set up where people aren't stealing from you, where you can run it with very little involvement, if that's you, then by all means, go and do it. You obviously have the means and the experience to do this. But overall, if you're single and you're in the dating pool, and you're going to try to open up a retail business, and you think you're going to have success managing a business, dating, having a social life, having a personal life, and also doing other things, whether you have a corporate job or you're involved in other investments, I got news for you. It is probably not going to work out to your benefit. And if you're juggling multiple things, a lot of those things are going to crash and burn. And you're really going to have to pick up the pace, because now if you're struggling in this retail business, you're going to have to divert a lot of assets, resources, and time to that business to get it to work, just so you can take a step back and start to live your life. This is not a place that I would want to be in my 40s, in my 50s, and especially not in my 60s. And that's why I tell you guys, because there's a lot of you that are in your 20s and 30s that want to do this. When you get to your 40s, I can tell you firsthand, your perspectives are probably going to change, and you're going to get to the point where, you know what, this is not something I want to dive into. I have seen marriages fall apart because one of the people in that partnership, in that marriage, in that relationship, they want to pursue their dreams. And sometimes their dreams are not really realistic. And the other person tries to support them. They try to stay around. They try to offer support in the business or the idea that they have. And usually it ends up tanking the relationship. I'm going to be very honest. I have done a lot of consulting with people that literally confide in me. Sean, I thought this was the answer. It cost me my marriage. It cost me, you know, my kids. It cost me a ton of money to the point where now I'm working two jobs in corporate America trying to get back to where I was 10 years ago. Now, there is another thing, and this leads into it, that is a major pitfall for people wanting to do this, especially in the year 2021. Can you guess what it is? It is a lack of capital and or a lack of business experience. I am going to tell you, in my opinion, I don't care if you're successful selling online or you're unsuccessful selling online. If you're going to jump right in to retail sales, you should have experience and a boatload of capital. Now, I know what you're going to say. Well, Sean, how much capital should I have? Well, what is it that I tell you guys? If you want to get involved in these markets, you should already have, I hate to say it, a six-figure net worth. If you don't even have six figures to your name, you should not be doing anything in these markets, not even thinking about opening up a retail store. Now, if you come to me, you say, Sean, I got a $250,000 net worth. I got a $500,000 net worth. I really want to do this. I'm thinking of devoting 30, 40, 50, 60 hours a week to this. I really want to make it go. I want to make it work. I'm willing to put $100,000, $150,000 in startup capital into this business. I will tell you, if you want me to review your plan, I'll happily set up a call with you. I'll gladly do it. Even if you email me and just say, hey, Sean, here's some basic numbers. You email me 1 to 2 paragraphs free of charge. You'll probably get a response from me. And most likely, I'm going to state this, it's going to be negative. I'm probably going to tell you, please do not do this. Now, that's why some of you that email me, I email back and I say, what are the demographics of the location that you're going into? Where are you buying this property? Are you renting? What's the specifics? Because that's the best way that I can guide you. But overall, guys, I would never, ever advise any of you. Again, I don't care if you're on the antique side of the equation. I don't care if you're on the collectible side of the equation. In 2021, there are no benefits, in my opinion, to opening up a retail brick and mortar store in the collectibles and or antiques trade. Everything that is sold in those markets at present time can easily be sold online. They can be flipped online. And if you're talking about the high-end, top-tier market, most people who are getting in to the top 5% of the antiques trade, to the top 5% of the rare coin marketplace, top 5% of the antiquities market or graded currency market, they already work with dealers, auction houses, and the like. And the same thing is true if you look on the collectible side of the equation. There's a lot of people that know who the top tier dealers are in comic books, vintage comic books, CGC graded comic books. So in my opinion, even if you have access to a vast collection of vintage comic books that you know is worth like $2 million, $3 million, maybe you inherited a collection from a relative, or you've been collecting them for years and the collection just blew up in value, in my assessment, if you want to sell that collection, don't open up a retail store to do it. Get them graded, consign them to Comic Link, Heritage, Comic Link, and others, or reach out to dealers, or even sell them on eBay yourself. You will be a lot happier and a lot wealthier in most cases in the long run. That's the end of the lesson today. Hope you got something out of this. If you need me to do a sequel to this video, or you need me to do a follow-up of some type because I missed something, let me know in the comment section below. But just to review, the three pitfalls are lack of capital, not understanding the time demands, and not being realistic of the market opportunities as they sit at present day in the overall antiques and collectibles trade. Thank you for watching and have a great night.